So, good day to everyone. Last video lecture discussion, I've talked about the feed elements. So, I've talked about the water, the importance of water, the where water comes from, kung ano yung sources ng water dun sa ng animal, and then kung ano paano ma-absorb yung water. And then I've also talked about the carbohydrate, mainly on the first part, the importance, the function of carbohydrates, as well as the different types and subtypes, or different categories, different class and subclass of carbohydrates, from monosaccharides, disaccharides, yun. So, for today, I'm going to talk about the gas production, as well as the absorption of volatile fatty acid and so on. So, as a review, the gas production in the rumen, I'm sure may na-mention na noon sa inyo kung ano yung mga na-produce or kung ano yung mga na mga animals that can produce yung mga gases, and one of those is yung ruminant. So the rate of gas production in the rumen is most rapid immediately after a meal. So sinasabi daw na yung gas production daw nasa peak or nag-increase or mataas yung rate ng gas production pag after daw na kumain yung isang ruminant. So indikaw gas production may exceed 30 liters per hour. So yun, 30 liters daw. So ganung karami yung na-produce na gas ng cow. So yun yung parang main reason kung bakit culprit or large emitter ng gas itong cow, ng mga kung bakit parang may big part yung mga cows, yung mga ruminants dun sa climate change, dun sa global warming na tinatawag, kasi mataas silang mag-produce ng gas. So, in the rumen, the gas is composed. So, dito, you have yung carbon dioxide, yung methane, yung hydrogen, and then yung oxygen and nitrogen may na-produce rin but in small amount. So, ito yung parang harmful gas, itong methane. So, it is a byproduct dun sa fermentation ng mga carbohydrates. So, itong methane gas, ito yung parang nakakasira dun sa kalikasan daw. Kaya, parang hindi nila gusto yung medyo malalaking farms, yung mga malalaking ranches, kasi they are big emitters, yung mga cows nila, they are big emitters of methane gas, which is harmful to the environment. So yun. So that's for the gas production in the rumen. Then the carbon dioxide is produced by carbohydrate fermentation. So yun, in fermenting yung carbohydrate daw, nakakapag-produce ka ng carbon dioxide. And then yung quantity ng methane, it depends on the type of food eaten. So yung 4.5 grams daw ng methane for every 100 grams of carbohydrates, yun yung na-produce, 4.5 grams of methane. So ganun karami. So and then ruminants will lose around 7% of its food energy as methane. So yun. Medyo marami rin yung 7% ng na-produce or na-intake na energy ay nawawala lang kasi sa pag-produce mo ng methane. So that's for the gas production in the rumen. Then we will go now to the absorption of volatile fatty acid. So on the last video lecture that I uploaded, I've talked about how volatile fatty acids are made. So yung volatile fatty acid, as a simple explanation, yung kinain na grass ng ruminant mako-convert into starch, or yung starch dun sa grass na kinain ng ruminant mako-convert into glucose. Now this glucose will be then further converted into pyruvic acid. Now, this pyruvic acid again will be further converted into this volatile fatty acid. So, itong mga volatile fatty acid na to, I hope alam nyo pa yung butyric, propionic, and acetic acid. Now, these VFAs, most of the VFAs are absorbed directly from the rumen, reticulum, and omasum. So, yun, laging tatandaan na yung mga na-produce na VFA, yung acetic, butyric, propionic acid, na-absorb, most of them na-absorb dun sa rumen, reticulum, and omasum. A little amount, nababypass itong mga rumen, reticulum, omasum, pumupunta dun sa small intestine, pero little amount lang. Majority of VFA, dito sila na-absorb. Dito sa rumen, reticulum, and omasum. So, laging tatandaan yan. Then, some of the VFAs are used by bacteria and protozoa to synthesize their own protein. So, that's what's unique about the ruminants. So, may mga bacteria, may mga protozoa sila doon sa rumen wherein they are able to utilize itong VFA to produce their own protein. Kaya sa ruminants, may tinatawag tayong microbial protein. So, nanggaling ito dun sa mga microbes and bacteria that can produce protein through yung utilization nila ng VFA. So, yun. So, we go to the carbohydrate metabolism. So, dun sa absorption lang naman, I hope ma-remember nyo pa sa meta sa biology nyo kung paano na-absorb yung mga substances doon sa villi, mga ganun. Pero, ang yung laging tatandaan lang is that sa rumen, reticulum, umasog. Sila na-absorb. So, we go now to the carbohydrate metabolism. So, for the carbohydrate metabolism, we're still talking about yung mga VFA. Kasi ito yung parang second to the last end product ng metabolism. So, in the ruminants, considerable amount of carbohydrates are converted into VFA. So, yun, nasabi ko na. Basta tandaan nyo, yung mga carbohydrates, mako-convert lahat sila, mako-convert most of the carbohydrates into volatile fatty acid. So, itong volatile fatty acid are then metabolized in the liver and will produce ATP. So, after na-convert yung carbohydrate into VFA, mame-metabolize ulit doon sa liver itong mga VFA to produce yung ATP. Now, this ATP, itong adenosine triphosphate, alam naman natin na this is the source of energy ng animal. So, this is where yung energy nila for maintenance, for growth, for reproduction, for lactation, at kung anumang body processes yan, nag-expend sila ng ATP or energy. So, sa acetic acid, which is VFA, 10 ATP yung napoproduce. Then, for propionic acid, nasa 17 ATP yung napoproduce. And then, yung butyric acid, nasa 25 ATP yung napoproduce. So, yun. Talagang good source of energy itong carbohydrate sa ruminants kasi nakakapag-produce sila ng VFA wherein nakakapag-produce or na-metabolize yung VFA into this many ATP. So, paano nga ba na-metabolize itong acetic acid, propionic acid, and butyric acid? So, first is the acetic acid metabolism. So, ito, kasi medyo complicated na if we're going to talk about all of this at a time. Itong mga TCA or tricarboxylic acid cycle, mga ganito. So, yung laging tatandaan lang, there is a net 10 ATP are produced per mole of acetic acid. So, one molecule ng acetic acid daw, yung napoproduce niya is 10 ATP. So, paano nga ba yun? So, yung sa pag-metabolize ng acetic acid, kailangan ng dalawang ATP para ma-convert into acetyl-CoA. So, yun. Yun lang yung tatandaan, yung acetic acid mako-convert into acetyl-CoA pero kailangan niya ng dalawang ATP. Then, by the conversion, pag na-convert yung acetic acid into acetyl-CoA, kailangan niya ng 2 ATP then makakapag-produce rin siya ng 2 AMP or adenosine monophosphate. Now, this adenosine monophosphate, parang kailangan rin to in the production of ATP. So, yon. Again, acetic acid with 2 ATP, na kailangan niya ng 2 ATP, magiging acetyl-CoA. Now, this acetyl-CoA will then be further metabolized into carbon dioxide and H2O plus energy. So, sa pag-convert or sa pag-metabolize ng acetyl-CoA into CO2 plus H2O, nakakapag-produce ka ng 12 ATP. So, bakit nga ba net 10 ATP lang yung na-produce niya? At 12 ATP naman yung na-produce. So, remember na dito sa una, gumasto ka ng 2 ATP. Gumasto yung body ng animal ng 2 ATP para ma-convert yung acetic acid to acetyl-CoA. So, 12 minus 2, that's a net 10 ATP. So, yun. Laging tatandaan yun. That's for acetic acid metabolism. So, if you want to review more on it, then you could search on Google and then rewind my explanation on it. That's the simplest explanation mismo. So, yun. Basta laging tatandaan sa acetic acid metabolism, acetic acid, then acetyl-CoA, and then CO2 plus H2O plus energy. And yung na-produce niya is 12 ATP, pero gumagasto siya ng 2 ATP, kaya yung net ATP lang niya is 10. So, that's for acetic acid metabolism. Then, we have propionic acid metabolism. So, there's some complicated or mga iba-ibang mga substances yung dadaanan ng propionic acid bago siya maging converted into glucose. So, yung ang ano lang naman ito, yung propionic acid, by the aid of the coenzyme A, magiging propionyl-CoA. Pero kailangan niya ng 2 ATP. Then, yung propionyl-CoA, gagasto ulit ng ATP, with the aid of the biotin enzyme, magiging methylmalonyl-CoA, and then, magko-convert into succinyl-CoA, and then into malate, and then into oxaloacetate, and then popoenol pyruvate, and then, lastly, into glucose. So, yun yung, ano, so, we're not going to talk about, we're not going to delve more into itong mga, ano, itong mga methylmalonyl-CoA, succinyl-CoA. Basta, alam nyo lang na yung propionic acid, at the end of its pag na-end na yung metabolism niya, magiging glucose. So, ito yung na-expend na ATP nung pag-convert ng propionic acid into glucose, at ito yung na-produce. So, ito. So, 2 moles of propionate, yung propionic acid, to 2 moles of succinyl-CoA, na kailangan niya ng 6 ATP para ma-convert into 2 moles of succinyl-CoA. So, yon. Then, yung 2 moles na succinyl-CoA na na-produce, mako-convert into 2 moles of malate. By converting yung 2 moles of succinyl-CoA into 2 moles of malate, nakakapag-produce ka ng 6 na ATP. Then, yung 2 moles of malate na na-produce, na mako-convert into 2 moles of phosphoenol pyruvate, makakapag-produce ka ng 6 ATP, pero gagasto ka ng 2 ATP. Now, this 2 moles of phosphoenol na na-produce, phosphoenol pyruvate na na-produce, mako-convert into 1 mole of glucose. Dito, pag na-kinonvert mo into 1 mole of glucose, gagasto ka ng 8 ATP. Now, yung 1 mole of glucose to CO2 and H2O, makakapag-produce ka ng 30 ATP at wala kang magagasto. So, yun. So, yun yung summary nung na-produce na ATP and yung nagasto na ATP on the conversion or metabolism of propionic acid into glucose and then into CO2 and H2O. So, if we sum it all up, yung na-produce na ATP nasa 50 ATP, 50 mol of ATP. Then, yung nagasto na ATP nasa 16 molecules of ATP. So, yung kanina, yung pinakita ko, yung ma-produce na ATP nung 1 molecule of propionic acid, 17. Ito, hindi naman magtatali. Kasi 50 minus 16, hindi naman 17. So, dapat i-divide muna natin sa 2 molecules. 50 minus 16 divided by 2 is equal to 17. Bakit natin i-divide sa 2 moles of propionate? Kasi yung hinahanap natin, yung ina-explain ko lang is 1 mole of propionic acid. Yung sa pag-convert ng propionic acid, kailangan mo ng 2 moles. Yung sinasabi lang, yung pinakita ko lang is 1 mole of propionic acid. So, 50 minus 16 divided by 2, that is equal to 17 ATP. So, that's for propionic acid. So, laging tatandaan itong mga to. Laging tatandaan kasi lalabas sa quiz, lalabas sa exams, lalong-lalo na sa board. So, basta sa acetic acid, nasa 10 ATP yung na-produce niya. For this propionic acid, nasa 17 ATP. So, yun. And then we have butyric acid. So, yung B-hydroxybutyrate or yung butyric acid natin, makakapag-produce siya ng 1 ATP and then mako-convert into acetoacetic acid. Then itong acetoacetic acid mako-convert into 2-acetyl-CoA and then itong 2-acetyl-CoA makakapag-produce siya ng 24 ATP plus CO2 and H2O. So there's a net 25 ATP that are produced per mole of butyric acid. So notice na wala siyang na-expend or wala siyang nagasto na ATP. Na-produce lang, nakapag-produce lang. So, yun. So, again, inulit ko, acetic acid, it has 10 ATP na ma-produce. By then, it's of its metabolism. For propionic acid, it has nasa 17 molecules yung ng ATP yung na-produce by the end of its metabolism. And then, for butyric acid, nasa 25 ATP yung na-produce. So those are the carbohydrate metabolism, specifically on the VFA or the volatile fatty acid. Now, after niya ma-metabolize, then we're going to talk about how the digestion of carbohydrates in non-ruminants naman. Kasi sa yung diniscuss ko ay sa ruminants doon. Kung paano nila kinonvert, paano nila dinigest, break down yung carbohydrate into pyruvic acid into VFA. Kasi meron sila nung rumen reticulum umasok nila. Then, paano naman doon sa non-ruminants? So, when we say non-ruminants, ito yung mga monogastric. So, first, let's discuss the digestion of carbohydrate in the mouth. So, the food is mixed with the saliva which contains the enzyme thiolin or alpha amylase. So, itong alpha amylase na to, ito yung enzyme na parang it will digest yung hydrolyze yung starch into maltose and isomaltose. So, yung starch nang galing yon sa grass or sa feed na kinain nung non-ruminant. So, yun. So, mako-convert ngayon yung starch dun sa feed into maltose and isomaltose by the aid of the amylase, yung salivary amylase na tinatawag. Then, the food will remain in the mouth for a short time and about 3 to 5% of the starch is hydrolyzed into maltose. So, yun. Basta laging tatandaan sa non-ruminants, yung digestion nila in the mouth ng carbohydrate, ang main enzyme na nag-aano doon, nag-aaction, nagte-take action is yung salivary amylase or yung thiamin na tinatawag. Yung salivary amylase, it will convert starch into isomaltose and maltose. So yun, that's for digestion in the mouth. Then the alpha amylase will hydrolyze the bond on the polysaccharide which gives rise to a mixture of glucose and maltose. So yun, ina-hydrolyze, binabreak down yung polysaccharide doon sa feed, o doon sa carbohydrate, or yung polysaccharide which give rise to glucose and maltose. Then after nandun sa mouth, we're pupunta doon sa stomach. So, sa digestion of carbohydrate in the stomach, yung action ng alpha amylase or yung thiamin will continue for about 30 to 50 minutes after the food has entered the stomach. So, yun, laging tatandaan na hindi porket umalis na yung food doon sa mouth, eh mawawala na yung bisa ng alpha amylase. So, after na nag-enter yung food doon sa stomach, the action, yung pag-breakdown ng alpha amylase doon sa starch will continue for about 30 to 50 minutes. Then yung food or yung fundus will now mix with the stomach secretion. So may mga secretions doon sa stomach and maghalo-halo na mga ito. Then the acid of the gastric secretion will block the activity of the salivary amylase. So after about 30 to 50 minutes, since naghalo-halo na yung mga acid, yung mga gastric juices, yung mga secretions doon sa stomach, it will block the activity of the salivary amylase. Then the acid of the stomach juice can hydrolyze the starch and polysaccharide even more. So yun, you have here yung mga acid ng stomach juice. Sila yung mag-prefer their breakdown dun sa starch and polysaccharide dun sa carbohydrate. So, laging tatandaan bakit nila binibreakdown to, bakit hindi nila i-absorb na mismo. So, large molecules kasi to. Medyo malaki pa to for absorption, itong mga polysaccharide, mga starch, kaya hindi pa pwedeng i-absorb. Dapat i-breakdown pa further para ma-absorb. Then, also, after dun sa stomach, you have yung digestion of carbohydrate in the intestine. So, yung digestion naman ng carbohydrate in the intestine, pancreatic secretion that goes into the intestine is able to split starch into maltose and isomaltose. So, ito, parang itong pancreatic secretion na ito, parang yun yung action ng salivary amylase. It can also split yung starch into maltose and isomaltose. So in general, the starch is almost totally converted into maltose and isomaltose before they pass the jejunum. So yung jejunum, ito yung small intestine, part ng small intestine. You have duodenum, jejunum, and then ileum. So yun, sa first part pa lang, sa duodenum pa lang, na-convert na totally yung starch into maltose and isomaltose. Pero pag hindi pa na-convert dun, then a small amount will pass into the jejunum at doon siya ma-convert. So yun, that's for the digestion of carbohydrate in the intestine. So, the epithelial cells of the small intestine contains the four enzymes. So, doon rin sa small intestine, may mga enzymes rin na nandun, nagsisecret. Yung epithelial cell ng small intestine, it contains this enzyme. So, yung lactase, this is the enzyme. So, notice that sucrase, lactase, maltase, isomaltose, also maltase dapat to, it ends all of yung mga enzymes na to by ASE or ACE. So, not all enzymes parang ganito, pero most of it, ganito yung ano, yung pag-end nung word nila or yung pangalan ng enzyme. Lactase, sucrase, maltase, isomaltase, may ACE dun sa dulo. So, nakakatulong to in parang distinguishing pag magpa-quiz ako kung ano pag sasabihin ko kung ano yung enzyme dito, then madali lang ma-distinguish. So, yung lactase, it will split yung lactose into glucose and galactose. So, laging tatandaan, pag lactase, in-split niya yung lactose. Kasi lactase, lactose. So, yung lactase split lactose into glucose and galactose. Then, yung sucrase will split sucrose into glucose and fructose. Then, the maltase will split maltose into two molecules of glucose. And then, yung isomaltose will split isomaltase will split isomaltose into two molecules of glucose. So, ito yung mga enzymes that will further hydrolyze, that will further break down the mga carbohydrates, itong mga lactose, sucrose, maltose, isomaltose, into this glucose, galactose, glucose, fructose, and then two molecules of glucose, two molecules of glucose. So, yun. Yan yung mga digestion in the intestine. May mga enzymes dun sa small intestine that will further break down yung carbohydrate. So, ito yung summary kung paano nga ba na yung sa digestion ng carbohydrate in non-ruminant. So, first, yung starch. Saan galing yung starch? Dun sa feed ng animal. Then, by the action of the salivary amylase and the pancreatic amylase, the starch will be converted into maltose and isomaltose as well as lactose and sucrose. So, yun. Yung salivary amylase, pancreatic amylase, will convert yung starch to maltose, isomaltose, lactose, and sucrose. Now, itong maltose, isomaltose, lactose, sucrose, dadaan yan doon sa small intestine. Now, binanggit ko kanina na doon sa small intestine, meron kang mga enzymes na will further break down this itong mga to. So, for lactose, yung lactase doon sa intestine will be converted into galactose and glucose. Now, the maltose and isomaltose, by the aid of the maltase enzyme doon sa at saka yung isomaltase na enzyme doon sa intestine, it will be converted into glucose. Then, yung sucrose, by the aid of the enzyme sucrase, it will, in the intestine, it will be converted into fructose and glucose. So, yun. So, itong summary na to, alam nyo na. Makikita nyo na kung ano yung kung paano yung digestion ng carbohydrate in non-ruminant. So, yun. Then, as a summary, kung ano nga ba yung mga digestive juices and their function. First is yung saliva. Yung salivary gland. It will secrete yung saliva which contains yung salivary amylase. So, yung function niya, paulit-ulit, it acts on the starch and it split it into dextrin and maltose. Or, most of it dito sa maltose at saka sa dextrin. Then, yung gastric gland naman na matatagpuan doon sa stomach, it will secrete itong gastric juice. So, itong gastric juice na ito, it contains yung pepsin. Now, itong pepsin na to, it will degrade protein into smaller units called peptides. So, I guess, ito summary na lahat, not just on carbohydrates. So, itong pepsin, laging tatandaan, it will degrade protein into smaller units called peptides. So, itong pepsin, component siya nung gastric juice. Then, sa gastric gland pa rin, you have also yung hydrochloric acid na tinatawag. So, ito yung parang main na tinitignan nila when it comes to distinguishing yung true stomach. Kasi sa ruminant, di ba, sinasabi nila na may four compartments. Rumen, reticulum, umasum, and abomasum. Now, sinasabi nila na yung abomasum daw, yung true stomach, kasi dito, na nagsisecrete ng hydrochloric acid. So, yun. So, itong hydrochloric acid, component siya ng gastric gland or yung gastric juice. So, itong hydrochloric acid will stop the action of the salivary amylase and allows the pepsin to work, and then it will kill yung microorganism kasi nga acidic. So, nabanggit kanina na yung action ng salivary amylase, 30 to 50 minutes after na nag-enter dun sa stomach, nagte-take action pa rin yung salivary amylase, but after that, it will stop because of the hydrochloric acid. Now, another one is renin. Nandun rin, a component rin ng gastric juice. So, itong renin na to, it is a protein digesting enzyme that curdles milk. So, it mainly acts on the milk. So, when we say curdle, it means coagulate into smaller clumps, parang mga bola-bola. Into smaller clumps. And itong renin, it is only present doon sa mga cud chewing na tinatawag, or it is only present doon sa mga ruminants such as cow. Then, another gland is yung itong secretion, another secretion is yung bile juice. Sorry, baliktad to. Ito yung liver, yung gland, and then yung secretion niya is bile juice. Yung principal component is bile. So, yun. Please, take note to, tong kamali dito. So, yung gland is yung liver, yung secretion niya is bile juice, and yung principal component is bile. Then, the function of it, it is neutralize the acidity of chyme and stop action of the pepsin. So, itong chyme na to, ito yung food na kinain ng animal, yung na-digest na. So, neutralize kasi, inyo-neutralize na kasi nga, dumaan siya dun sa hydrochloric acid, dun sa acid juices na nandun sa stomach. So, it will neutralize yung acidity. Then, it will also stop the action of the pepsin. Then, yung pinaka-importanteng function ng bile, it allows action of the intestinal enzymes and then emulsify fat. So, yun yung mga important function niya. Emulsifies fat. So, fat emulsification is the process of increasing the surface area of fats in the small intestine. So, ito yung responsibility ng bile. Then, we also have the pancreas. So, itong pancreas naman, it will secrete yung pancreatic juice na tinatawag. Now, yung principal component ng pancreatic juice is yung pancreatic lipase. So, itong pancreatic lipase na to, it will participate on the breakdown and hydrolysis of fat. So, yun. More on the hydrolysis or breakdown of fat. Although, itong topic natin is on carbohydrate, mahalagang or mas maganda if malaman natin yung mga different glands that will secrete these different enzymes. So, like for example, itong pancreatic lipase will break down yung and hydrolyze yung fat. Then, another one on the pancreas is yung trypsin and chymotrypsin. So, itong trypsin and chymotrypsin breaks down protein into amino acid. So, although hindi pa natin madi-discuss, I know na alam nyo na na yung amino acid are the building blocks of protein. And ito yung amino acid are used in the body for many functions. So, yun. Then, after that, you have yung mga duodenal gland. So, yung duodenal, ito yung sa duodenum, which is part of the small intestine. So, it will, yung sinisecrete niya is intestinal juices. Yung principal component doon is enterokinase. Now, this enterokinase will activate yung trypsinogen into trypsin. Yun lang yung function niya. It will activate trypsinogen into trypsin. Itong trypsin na to, it will break down yung protein into amino acid. Then, yung peptidases naman doon sa duodenal gland, it will also split amino acid. And then, yung maltase split maltose into glucose, sinabi ko na yan. Yung sucrase, split sucrose into glucose and fructose. Yung lactase, split lactose into glucose and galactose. So, yun. Yung mga different parts or different secretions ng mga glands dun sa digestive digestive ng non-ruminants. Then after niya na-digest yung mga carbohydrates, pupunta naman tayo dito sa absorption niya. So yung mga, di ba, nabanggit kanina yung mga carbohydrates will be then converted itong mga glucose, galactose, and fructose. Ito na yung pwedeng ma-absorb doon sa body ng non-ruminant. So itong glucose, galactose, and fructose are absorbed in an active process that uses carrier proteins to transport the molecules across the brush borders membrane of the small intestine. So, parang sinasabi lang na itong mga glucose, galactose, and fructose na to, by the aid of the carrier protein, parang sasakay sila dito sa carrier protein, then matra-transport sila across the brush borders. So, when we say brush borders, ito na yung nasa sa villi, sa parang edge or side nung or border nung small intestine, may mga structures doon that will absorb yung mga molecules na to. Then itong molecules na ito then pupunta into the bloodstream and into the different parts of the body to be used for the various processes in the body. So this process is energy dependent and requires sodium and potassium. Yung pag-absorb mo ng mga carbohydrate, it is energy dependent at kailangan niya ng sodium and potassium. Then yung mga factors that will affect yung digestion of carbohydrates in sa non-ruminants ay itong mga to. Itong particle size. So itong particles particle size na ito, mahalaga to in parang mahalagang factor to doon sa pagdadigest at ng carbohydrates sa non-ruminants, because if yung particle size is reduced, then yung digestibility will increase because of the increased surface area. So mas maganda na mas maliit yung particle size nung ina-absorb mo o yung dinadigest mo para madaling ma-digest. Mas madaling ma-digest if mas maliit yung particle size. And then another one is the form of starch. So, yung mga form of starch, you have yung soluble starch and insoluble starch. So, sa pangalan pa lang, alam mo na yung mga soluble starch, these are more digestible than yung mga insoluble starch. So, factor rin yon dun sa form of starch. Mas madaling i-digest yung soluble starch. And then, you have here yung processing na tinatawag. Processing doon sa feed. So, it will add parang yung processing, like for example, sa processing, you have yung cooking. So, yung cooked na starch, it is more digestible than yung uncooked. So, mas madaling ma-digest yung cooked na food, cooked na starch, kaysa dun sa hindi. Then, another one is fiber content. So, if yung fiber content is increased more than a level, it will reduce the digestibility of the carbohydrate. So, yun. Kung mas mataas daw yung fiber content na kinain ng animal, mas mahirap daw i-digest yung carbohydrate. And then we have here yung mga enzyme inhibitors na tinatawag. So ito namang mga enzymes inhibitors na ito, presence ng mga enzyme inhibitors like yung mga saponin, mga tanin. Itong mga saponin and tanin, ito yung mga enzyme inhibitor na natatagpuan mismo dun sa halaman, dun sa feed, sa feed resources. So, presence nito, it will reduce the digestibility of starch. Kasi enzyme inhibitors. So, pag naginig kayo, alam nyo na yung mga main parang sala rin kung bakit nadadigest natin yung mga carbohydrates ay yung mga enzymes. Kung may enzyme inhibitor, ini-inhibit nila, dina-block nila yung action ng mga enzymes, which means na re-reduce yung digestibility ng carbohydrates. So yun. So that's I think that's it for now pa lang. Kasi for the next topic, medyo mahirap na, we're going to talk about sa carbohydrate metabolism. So that's all for this video lecture. So I hope na you can able to view it, you can able to internalize it, you can able to review it, itong video lecture na to. So I will be uploading yung Google Drive link nito, i-upload ko sa MVLE, and then I will also be providing you yung PDF niya, as well as I will be uploading it to YouTube, kasi parang mas madaling i-download sa YouTube itong mga video lectures, at mas madaling panoorin dun sa YouTube. So yun lang muna, and I will see you sa next week, Thursday ulit. I know, Wednesday. I will see you next week, Wednesday, 3 o'clock. So, ano na lang yung lab exercise ninyo. Huwag niyong kalimutan na isend sa akin. So, that's all for now. Thank you for listening.